if we didn't deliver this procurement exercise in keeping with the necessary procurement legislation.
That ends topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Paul Wheelhouse on the Scottish Government report on the operation of the Offensive Behaviour at Football and Threatening Communications Scotland Act 2012. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement and there should therefore be no interventions or interruptions. And I'll give the Minister a few moments to get settled. Minister, Paul Wheelhouse, about 10 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, last Friday we published our report on the operation of the Offensive Behaviour at Football and Threatening Communications Scotland Act 2012. In doing so, we have fulfilled our requirement in Section 11 of the Act to report on the operation of the offences covered by Sections 1 and 6 of the Act by 1 August this year. Since June 2013, researchers at University of Stirling and Scotsend Social Research have been carrying out extensive evaluation of the Act, hearing evidence from a wide range of stakeholders, including fans, match commanders, police, prosecutors and football club representatives. The resulting independent evaluation covers Section 1 of the Act, offensive behaviour at regulated football matches, and is one of the pieces of supporting evidence that is central to our report. The second piece of evidence that our report is founded on is an evaluation of Section 6 of the Act, Threatening Communications, produced by the Scottish Government's Justice Analytical Services Division. Presiding Officer, while the Act is a high-profile and important piece of legislation, it is by no means the only measure this Government has deployed to tackle offensive behaviour and crimes associated with different forms of hatred. However, I hope to set out why I believe the Act remains a tool that should remain available to the police and courts. I will also set out where I believe there is scope for improving implementation and operation of the Act, and am keen to work with all partners to do this. The basis for moving forward is the evaluation, recommendations and suggested improvements in relation to how the Act is applied and used. I am keen to supplement this by hearing from those who have an interest in the legislation, who want to respond to the recommendations and who have ideas for improving the operation of the Act. Our ongoing aim, though, is to learn from evidence and improve implementation of the Act. The work undertaken by the independent research team indicates that the majority of the people of Scotland, including football fans, have had enough of football being used as an outlet for offensive, bigoted and abusive behaviour. Scotland is moving on from the prejudices of the past, and I believe a clear majority supports the sentiment that Scottish football needs to move with the times. The evaluation shows that hateful and offensive activity has been a declining phenomenon at football in recent seasons, since the Act was introduced, in terms of the number of charges reported to prosecutors by the police. Updated hate crime figures published last Friday indicate it has now fallen even further than reported in the evaluation, with offences under the Act falling 28% since the first year of operation. I wholeheartedly welcome the decline in offences under the Act. These reflect an opinion we observe through other work that we have been delivering, particularly in relation to tackling sectarianism, where the public tell us time and again that they are tired of the worn-out rhetoric of bigotry that has no place in modern Scotland. The Act has some harsh critics, and since taking on responsibility for this portfolio, I have been keen to understand the basis for that opposition and look at how legitimate concerns can be addressed to improve the implementation and operation of the Act. The Act was not created in a vacuum. It resulted from circumstances which simply could not be tolerated and which needed a strong policy response. Members may recall that during the 2010-11 football season, we saw an unacceptable level of sectarianism on Facebook and internet forums, blogs and social media, as well as a number of high-profile figures being targeted, with parcel bombs and death threats, alongside increased patterns of violence and disorder at some football matches. When Parliament legislates, it is choosing to communicate important messages. And in response to these events, this Act was stating that bigotry, prejudice and indeed the celebration of the loss of life and terrorist activity are unacceptable. There is no question about the fact that the vast majority of football supporters are well behaved and simply wish to support their team and enjoy the match day experience. I today acknowledge this good behaviour and self-policing where it occurs, as I have seen it at work. This positive behaviour is absolutely central to creating the atmosphere of friendly rivalry that allows everyone to enjoy our national sport without feeling abused, threatened or intimidated. It's therefore unsurprising that the evaluation highlights findings from surveys of supporters of Scottish football clubs conducted as part of the research, which show that a majority of football fans hold views which are broadly in line with the objectives of the Act. Football is not responsible in itself for giving rise to sectarianism or other forms of hatred that exist within society. To suggest otherwise would be wrong. However, regrettably, it is a means by which such hatred, abusive behaviour or sectarianism can manifest itself. For example, Recent research from the Scottish Social Attitude Survey conducted by ScotSend found that 88% of people identified football as a contributing factor to sectarianism in Scotland, and 55% highlighted it as the main contributing factor. In developing their evaluation, the University of Stirling and ScotSend Social Research consulted a wide range of stakeholders, including conducting an online supporter survey at the end of 2012-13 season and a further survey at the end of 2013-14 season, attracting a total of 4,130 responses. The survey sought views about matchday experiences since the legislation came into force, and supporters from all 42 professional league clubs were involved, with the strongest representation coming from Celtic, Hearts and Rangers fans. The results, validated through the focus group work, demonstrate that 90% of respondents to the fan survey found songs which glorify or celebrate the loss of life or serious injury offensive, 82% found songs in support of terrorist organisations offensive, 75% found songs, chants and shouting about people's religious background or beliefs at football matches offensive. We have never promoted the view that societal problems can be eradicated through legislation alone, as they are complex problems which can only be addressed through a range of activities. That is why the Act is part of our broader work to tackle abusive behaviour and has never been intended as a single fix. I recognise, though, that there are areas where improvements could be made. After all, this is still new legislation, and it is important that we consider where it's not working as effectively and take the appropriate steps to address that. For example, while policing at football matches is an operational matter for Police Scotland, there is an acknowledgement of the evaluation findings that the relationship between the police, football clubs and fans could be improved. I am keen to see this move forward and to work with all parties on positive engagement and improving levels of trust, and I know Police Scotland share this ambition from my discussions with them. In addition, I was delighted to be able to announce last Friday that I have extended the Diversion from Prosecution programme run by SACRO, Scotland's leading organisation for reducing offending in communities, as an alternative to prosecution. I know this chimes with concerns raised by football clubs and indeed by others such as fans against criminalisation. SACRO's programme, which will now cover all of Scotland, will ensure that when appropriate, people will be kept away from the criminal justice system and given appropriate alternative education programmes to make them understand the real impact of their actions, steer them away from getting caught in a downward spiral within the criminal justice system, and give them opportunities to make positive life changes. Clearly, where behaviours can be changed without giving first-time and low-tariff offenders a criminal record, this would, in our view, be desirable. Another area that I will be looking into is the application of football banning orders, the effectiveness of these as an intervention, and what improvements can be made to procedures to ensure they remain an effective tool for dealing with a wide range of negative behaviours associated with football. This will be taken forward in conjunction with the Scottish Court Service and the Crown Office. Again, a short-term banning order may be an appropriate alternative in some cases, and prosecutors may wish to use these as an alternative disposal. The Lord Advocate will be updating his guidelines on the Act to ensure that prosecutors are aware of the diversionary programme and are able to use it in all suitable cases. He will also be highlighting precedents established through case law to help clarify interpretation of the Act and achieve a more consistent approach to its application. And as well as taking the actions I have already mentioned, I am keen to hear further from those who have been critical of the Act so that I can identify and understand legitimate concerns they may have and how best to address those. Clearly, actions need to be evidence-based, and that is why I am also committed to continuing to monitor the operation of the Act and the effectiveness of the SACRO Diversion from Prosecution programme. But there are, of course, other issues highlighted in the evaluations, such as the fact that 60% of fans perceive they have not yet seen an improvement in behaviour, the comparatively low usage of the Act, and the time duration of court cases, a particular concern of fans' representatives. The implication of all of these findings need to be fully considered and, where appropriate, acted on. Presiding Officer, I am satisfied this evaluation meets our commitment to report to Parliament on the effectiveness of the Act, and it presents a strong, diverse and representative set of views, reflected through a robust and independent evaluation process. We have a thorough and robust understanding of the impact of the Act in the first two seasons of operation, and I thank University of Stirling and colleagues in Justice Analytical Services for providing a good basis for further progress. Tackling all forms of abusive behaviour, including abusive behaviour in and associated with football, is a priority for this government, and it is central to building an inclusive Scotland where all can live and raise their families in peace, without the fear of threats, abuse or prejudice. The Act remains an important tool for helping us to achieve that goal. Thank you.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members wish to ask a question or to press the request to speak button now. And I call Hugh Henry.
Presiding Officer, sectarianism and offensive behaviour is unacceptable, no matter where or when it occurs. Indeed, I am surprised and disappointed that 100% of those surveyed did not find this behaviour unacceptable. The question is what to do about it. This Act is controversial, not just with football fans. It has been criticised by sheriffs and other legal experts. Many have questioned whether most of the convictions under the Act could have been obtained using existing legislation. The Act has created a culture of mistrust between football fans and the authorities, not helped by the way some fans have been arrested at home in controversial circumstances. The research, while highlighting that football-related offences are down, concludes that this can possibly be attributed to other factors, and therefore it is impossible to determine whether some or indeed any of the reductions are in fact attributable directly to the Act. This research does not make clear whether or not the Act is effective. The Minister, Presiding Officer, has been disingenuous. A promise was in fact made to review the legislation. This work should be the start of that review. We all know that bigotry and intolerance isn't confined to football matches. Will the Minister commit to enhancing the investment in education? And will he commit to having a thorough review of what I believe is flawed legislation? We can do better than this. Scotland deserves effective action to tackle this age-old scourge.
Minister.
Well, Mr Henry makes a couple of points which I'm actually in agreement with him. I am disappointed 100% of fans and 100% of the population do not agree that this behaviour is offensive and should no longer continue. But we are where we are. We have to recognise the very strong support, which we should all welcome, I think, among fans and the general public about tackling all forms of offensive behaviour. The focus will inevitably be probably on sectarianism, but we've got homophobia, racism and other forms of offences. So that's very welcome. We have never said that offensive behaviour at football and Threatening Communication Act was the only tool in the box, and that's why we continue to invest £2.3 million in the current financial year in community-based activities, 38 projects across Scotland, which I believe will help tackle this from another angle and one that hopefully all members will support in doing so. So I do recognise the point. We're never claiming that the Offensive Behaviour Act would be the only thing that would solve this. And indeed, I take on board the messages that the researchers say in the difficulty in isolating the impact of a specific measure such as the Act in tackling sectarianism. But we should welcome the reduction in charges. We should welcome the fact that there is strong support for tackling the issue itself among fans and the wider public. And in terms of the commitment to review, this, as I said in my opening statement, that I do intend to continue to engage with those who have criticisms of the Act about how better we can implement the Act, and also to listen to specific concerns from clubs and fans and supporters about how we can police such issues as well. Police Scotland obviously have operational responsibility for dealing with these matters in the grounds and to and from the grounds, and I know they have a willingness to engage with fans on this and are looking to try and improve relations. So I think there's a good basis for going forward, and I certainly give my own commitment to keep an eye on what's happening in terms of the implementation of the Act and therefore to continue to review its effectiveness.
Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Minister for foresight of the statement, the gist of which appears to be a reaffirmation of what we already knew about the attitudes to offensive behaviour at football matches and a broadly upbeat assessment of how the legislation is working in practice in terms of the decline in football-related charges. However, can I point out that the report itself states that it is impossible to determine whether some or any of these reductions are attributable directly to the Act. What is evident from the Minister's statement is an emphasis not on continuing to make use of the Act, but rather to improving relationships, using diversion from prosecution, consideration of banning orders, and crucially, looking at guidelines to help clarify the interpretation of the Act. Isn't it simply time to repeal this ill-conceived legislation? And in terms of the concerns raised by the police, does the Minister consider the intense police resources it has taken up at the expense of policing more violent risk groups can be justified. And at the very least, can the Minister cite any examples that the review looked at specifically in terms of the prosecution process, which shows how inadequate the Act has been so far, leading to the necessity to clarify its interpretation?
Minister.
I certainly, in addressing the final point, first of all, Presiding Officer, I think I have to disagree with Margaret Mitchell. I think the kind of offences that are being committed under the Act have contributed to a wider situation where we have people fearing for their safety, but more specifically, the kind of general effect, the debilitating effect of having sectarianism and other forms of offensive, hatred-based offences happening in our society, which make people's lives on a day-to-day basis very difficult to live. So I think anything we can do is sending a strong signal through the Act to the wider population that the Scottish society in the 21st century does not support any form of discrimination or hatred which causes offence to people, and that in the past in parts of Scotland has led through to acts of physical violence and abuse. I think we have to make a clear statement there. So I appreciate the points that Margaret Mitchell is making, but I do believe it was important that Parliament set a strong signal to the Scottish population that this needed to be tackled. And I would also say that 80% of the public in the YouGov survey we published indicate support for the Act specifically. So not just support for legislation to tackle offensive behaviour, but specifically support for the Act. So there is some support out there for this. Strong support, and I do appreciate the issue about Police Scotland resources. Focus unit was set up specifically to try and improve the policing arrangements in and around football matches. I think that has been successful. It has been welcomed, I know, by clubs and by some supporters groups. The focus unit is working very effectively to try and finesse and fine-tune its policing approach. But we stopped funding Focus specifically as a standalone project, if you like, in 2012-13, at the end of 2012-13. So thereafter, the costs are being borne by Police Scotland. But they believe, Police Scotland, I know, believe this is an important area to tackle.
Thank you. Can I just advise members that we're very tight for time all afternoon? I have 12 members who wish to ask a question of the Minister, and I intend to finish no later than 2:50. So can I urge members to keep the question brief? And can I ask the Minister to keep the answer brief too? Roderick Campbell, followed by Michael McMahon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What further information can the Minister provide regarding the expansion of the Diversion from Prosecution programme?
Minister.
As I've already mentioned, the SACRA programme, which will cover all of Scotland, will ensure that, when appropriate, people will be kept away from the criminal justice system and given appropriate alternative education programmes, which is something that chimes with the point Mr Henry made, make them understand the real impact of their actions, steer them away from getting caught in a downward spiral within the criminal justice system, and give them opportunities to make life changes. I believe, as I've mentioned in my statement and recognised by Margaret Mitchell, Lord Advocate will importantly update his guidelines to make sure it's clear when that particular programme is most appropriate to be applied.
Mike McMahon, followed by Alice McInnes.
Thank you. Can I ask the Minister to firstly withdraw his claim that his views on the extension of diversion from prosecution chime with that of Fans Against Criminalisation? Nothing could be further from the truth, and he should not have made that claim. Fans Against Criminalisation see no succour to those who should not be facing prosecution in the first place in being diverted away from any prosecution. So can I also ask what efforts the Scottish Government has made to follow their commitments on a further equality impact assessment to assess the impact of the legislation is having on people of different races and ethnicities? And can you advise the Chamber how they've engaged with Scotland's multi-generational Irish community in particular?
Minister.
Well, in regards to the first point that Mr McMahon asked about, the discussions I've had, and I've had a very full and frank discussion with Fans Against Criminalisation about their views. It was very helpful. I know Mr McMahon's pointing, I'm aware, the members are in the chamber. Mr McMahon wasn't at the meeting, but we discussed with Fans Against Criminalisation. I know Mr Presiding Officer can
Minister.
Carry on without gesticulation from Mr McMahon. Fans Against Criminalisation and myself had a full and frank discussion where I'm fully aware of the criticisms of the Act from Fans Against Criminalisation, and I understand their perspective. But also we discussed would alternatives to prosecution be something they would be supportive of? And they certainly gave the impression to me, Mr McMahon, I appreciate you weren't there, that they were supportive of that. So I would hope the clue is in the name, Fans Against Criminalisation. If we can avoid criminalising fans unnecessarily, that would be something that they would support. And in relation to the other issues that Mr McMahon raises in regard to the strength of links with the Irish community, fully recognise that members of the Irish community in Scotland have a proud heritage, and I would be entirely supportive of them promoting their heritage. What we have to recognise is that, and the courts have done work on this through case law, there are certain songs and acts which can constitute an offence. That is for the courts to determine, not ministers. But there are clearly strong sentiments, and I recognise the strong views of Fans Against Criminalisation in this respect. But we will continue to have discussions with them about how we can improve the policing and implementation of this Act.
Alice McInnes, followed by John Mason.
Thank you very much. Can I actually welcome the funding for the Diversion from Prosecution projects? The Government will know that I've raised concerns about the dangers of disproportionate criminalisation, particularly of young men, and I do welcome that step that you've been taking. Can the Minister tell me what assessment has been made of how many people, particularly young people, might have been disproportionately criminalised as a result of the Act, and how many people each year does the Minister envisage will benefit from the Diversion from Prosecution?
Minister?
Presiding Officer, I'm happy to write to the Member with some detail, further detail about the underpinning of the financial figures we've used in funding programme, which will probably help explain the kind of estimates about numbers involved. I have had some informal discussions with SACRO, as have my officials, about the effectiveness of it. We do believe it is highly effective in having a 100% reduction in offending amongst those who have been going through it. So I very much welcome the Member's support for it. I know it's something that Alison McInnes has espoused herself, and I'm very grateful for her warm words today on the subject, and we'll make sure she gets the detail of the underpinning assumptions about the numbers going through the scheme.
John Mason, followed by Neil Findlay.
Thank you. I note from the report that the main victims of offensive behaviour seem to have been Catholics, some 84%, who have traditionally suffered from discrimination in Scotland. Therefore, does he consider that the main beneficiaries of the Act are likely to be Catholics and football supporters from a Catholic background?
Minister.
Well, it's certainly important. There are a number of different facets of hate crime that are covered by the Act, but clearly discrimination on the basis of religion is one that inevitably the debate founds on. It is true that 84% of all the charges in the most recent year were in relation to behaviour derogatory towards Roman Catholicism. That involved a reduction, welcome reduction in previous years. There are 6 charges for behaviour derogatory towards Protestantism, which is 12% of all charges, and 1 charge for behaviour derogatory towards Judaism and Islam. So I think the vast majority of the offences at the moment are in relation to Roman Catholicism and people abusing Roman Catholics. And I would certainly hope that people of that faith would welcome the Act in tackling the issue, but I would stress there has been welcome reduction in crimes against those who are Catholic and against those who are Protestant, both.
Neil Findlay, followed by Willie Coffey.
The appalling murders in France following the publication of cartoons in the Charlie Hebdo magazine had politicians of all parties declaring Je suis Charlie in defence of freedom of speech. Yet at the same time here, working class football fans are hauled before the courts for singing songs or wearing T-shirts that
I and
the Minister may not like. What does the Minister think of the double standards at play in relation to freedom of speech?
Minister.
Well, the first thing to say about the Act is it does not forbid freedom of speech in Scotland. What it does is regulate behaviour within regulated football matches in Scotland and travel to and from them, and in a situation which might prove inflammatory, perhaps in a public bar where the match is being shown. We are not saying that people are not entitled to have these views. They are entitled to have views, but they are not entitled to purvey them in a situation where they may cause offence and particularly lead to perhaps violence or hatred. And it is the case within football grounds that you have 2 teams and 2 sets of fans, and you have to accept the fact that it's not a homogeneous group of people within a football ground. Indeed, if I was to say in relation to the Stirling work, that University of Stirling work, that 47% of Celtic fans were certainly in support of tackling offensive behaviour in the form of singing in support of terrorist organisations and loss of life, and that outnumbered the number of Celtic fans who were against tackling that through legislation. So I think we need to get this in perspective. The majority of fans do support tackling offensive behaviour, and they do support the Act.
Willie Coffey, followed by Paul Martin.
Thank you. Can I ask the Minister if the Scottish Government will provide a briefing on the outcome of this review to the British-Irish Parliamentary Assembly, which I am a member of, so that they may receive a balanced view of the implementation of the Act?
Minister?
Well, I certainly would accept Mr Coffey's point that there are sensitivities around such issues, particularly as Mr McMahon has mentioned, in relation to the Irish community in Scotland. So I'm more than happy to make sure that all the material in relation to the evaluation, the government's report and response and the YouGov survey and any material we feel would be helpful will be sent to the association so they can deliberate that at their leisure. But I want to emphasise that we strongly support the Irish community in Scotland. This is about tackling behaviour which can potentially lead to disorder.
Paul Martin, followed by James Dornan.
Presiding officer, obviously offensive behaviour, and I hope the Minister agrees, is not exclusive to football fans. And of course, the second element of this legislation is respect of threatening communication. And that includes some of the online activity that we've seen take place, which is extremely hurtful to a number of individuals, which has been well publicised recently. Can the Minister advise me how many of those crimes have been recorded in over the last year?
Minister.
There are a relatively small number, as Mr Martin may well be aware, of offences under the Act. I suppose the issue that Mr Martin is trying to raise is if it would be a measure of success if there were more cases under the Act. I would hope that actually the Act has sent a strong signal that you need to behave yourself on social media and not to issue threatening communications. It's difficult to say, and I'm not attributing any views to Stirling University or indeed to our Justice Analytical Services, who did the work for Scottish Government in this respect, that they are saying that the Act has been responsible for a decline. But I am saying that we should be welcome the fact there are not more offences under the Act, because that means that hopefully people are observing the correct behaviours.
James Dornan, followed by John Pentland.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The evaluation found that in 2013-14, 22% of supporters attending away games heard negative references to a person's sexuality, yet the number of offences relating to sexuality under the Act is very low. What work is the Government taking forward to tackle homophobia in sport and the underreporting of homophobic offences?
Minister.
Well, I suppose it's a point that we should note, and I've tried to emphasise that the Act covers a form of behaviours which goes well beyond traditional sort of sectarianism and into homophobia, transphobia, biphobia and other offences. And Mr Dornan raised a very important point. The Scottish Government has funded Leap Sport Scotland, an organisation which works for greater inclusion of LGBT people in sport and against homophobia in a sports context since 2012, and is funding that to the tune of £38,800 in this current financial year. One of LEAP's objectives is to promote equality and diversity through challenging discrimination on the grounds of sexual orientation, and we believe that it's an effective means to address the issue of homophobia, biphobia and transphobia, and I hope I'll provide more details to Mr Dornan for his information.
John Pentland, followed by Gil Paterson.
The reduction in offensive activity is due to a number of factors, some predating the Act, and also part of a general reduction in violent crime. One factor that both the Minister and his predecessor stressed as crucial is education, yet this is undermined by a 25% cut in funding for projects such as Know By Mouth. Will the Minister assure us that the long-term future of educational programmes will be safeguarded?
Minister.
Well, Mr Pentland raises an important point. I'm very, very supportive of the activities done by Know By Mouth and other organisations on our behalf in the community. We invited those organisations to submit revised bids for the current year, fully in the knowledge that there would be a reduction in funding, because we do have a long-term commitment to try and phase out, not trying to create an industry here. Sectarianism is an industry that has a long-term future in Scotland. Far from it, we want to eliminate sectarianism. But I recognise the very important role that these organisations are playing. So we will continue to engage with partners such as Know By Mouth on very positive work they're doing in our schools. I've seen for myself just how valuable it is, but we have to recognise that the organisations need to work with stakeholders at a local level to try and mainstream that activity so it doesn't become project funded in perpetuity.
Gil Paterson, followed by Elaine Smith.
Yes, another question on young people in education. I note that the YouGov poll around found that 82% of respondents believe that offensive behaviour at and around football matches is harmful, and that is a bad influence on young people. Can the Minister expand on what work has been taken forward to better educate young people on the issues that can contribute to the offensive behaviour at football?
Minister.
Well, aside, Presiding Officer, from the SACRA scheme, which I'll not go over again, it's certainly a significant investment, which takes the total investment to around £140,000. We will provide further funding support through other organisations, the 38 community organisations I mentioned that are doing projects at a local level. Another scheme which is funded by Scottish Government is Community Links, which I also had the pleasure, Community Links Southern Lanarkshire, South Lanarkshire Anti-Sectarianism Project, which is another example of a project at a local level which is delivering social marketing campaigns and educating social media users of the risks of posting sectarianism and offensive material on Facebook, Twitter and similar sites. The work that is being done by Sensing Sectarianism within schools, Nil by Mouth and other organisations, including the Scottish Book Trust, who published a very useful graphic novel called Walk the Walk about sectarianism, I would certainly commend to the member, but I'll try and make sure the information is available to him.
Elaine Smith, followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and no doubt we all want to see bigotry, prejudice and religious hatred tackled in society, but there do remain concerns with this legislation. Further to Neil Finlay's question, can the Minister clarify for me, does he support the police interpretation then of offensive behaviour when it involves songs or banners in support of political standpoints or expressing cultural identity, which outside a football environment would certainly not be considered criminal? And overall, will the Scottish Government put specific resources into further training for police to stop this act being used unfairly and inappropriately?
Well, I'm happy, as I have been today, Presiding Officer, to go on the record to say we will continue to work with a number of partners, fans groups, clubs and others to make sure the implementation of the Act is as good as it can be. But in terms of the issue that is mentioned, in terms of the interpretation of particular songs or banners, I think that's a matter that's best left to the courts. There's a reason why it's not defined within the legislation itself. It's obviously there are tests in terms of what constitutes offensive behaviour within the Act, but we really need to leave that to the courts and the sheriffs to determine, based on case law, what they feel is appropriate or inappropriate in that setting. But I will happily commit to the member that we will continue to engage with, whether it's Fans Against Criminalisation, other groups, to try and ensure we improve the implementation of the Act where that can be done.
Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. The Minister tells us that he's keen to understand the basis for opposition to the Act. Isn't it clear from Parliament's official report that that was part of Parliament's concern when we passed an amendment at Stage 3 requiring Ministers to consult before preparing a report in the review period? Why is it that the Scottish Ministers themselves didn't consult publicly on this matter before commissioning this outsourced piece of research?
Minister.
Well, the outsourced piece of research that Mr Harvey refers to, Presiding Officer, was done by extremely reputable academics at Stirling University. I don't think, I'm not sure Mr Harvey's not casting any aspersions, but I just make the point that it's a high-quality piece of research done by independent researchers, and they have done extensive work in consulting with probably the very groups that Mr Harvey would want the government to engage with through a consultation exercise. We have had the evaluation. We believe there was nothing specified in the Act about how the review ought to be undertaken. We've done what we believe is the best thing to do in terms of undertaking the evaluation, and we've consulted with key groups, including Fans Against Criminalisation, who are invited to take part in that, and other supporters groups, clubs, Procurator, Fiscal Service, Police and other stakeholders. So it has been a wide-ranging evaluation that's brought in as much opinion as we can. I believe it is a fair reflection of those consultation inputs. But I take the point Mr Harvey makes, but I think we've done a successful exercise in terms of evaluating the Act, and I hope Parliament agrees.
Thank you. That ends the statement. Can I thank members and the Minister for allowing us to get through all the questions that people wanted to ask. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 13511 in the name of Derek Mackay on stage one of the Harbour Scotland Bill. Members who wish to take part in